Well, I know exactly what you're talking about. Joe Scamandella was the owner of Houston Staten Island. And he had a 121, and we had pretty good success with it, so he wanted to get another car. So we called it the 122. Well, we happened to be in the same race, and it was an accident, and I went in and demolished a 122, demolished a 121. And they towed it back in the pits on a wreckers, on two wreckers. And Joe Scamandella come down off the top of the truck and took the hood and jumped up and down and did it like a little monkey. He said, "You got everything but the goddamn tow truck." It was actually my cousin's car. And actually, back then in the race, we all got together and you would build a car. And we built one out of a 39 coupe and it had a 53 Mercury motor in it. And we're up in Nazareth, and Mario Andretti was driving a Hudson up there at the time. And we're going, and I got to be in second place, and my eyes was on the hook front of the hood. It was nowhere else. I don't know nothing. And I could go through the corner, but the carburetor would break up, and it would go bump, 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 so I could hold it wide open, and then it would go down the straightaway. Well, I went past Mario, but little did I know the yellow was out. And now I think I'm leaving, and I'm going right through the corner, and I come around, and here's four cars, one's upside down, the other two are wrecked and everything else. And I couldn't stop, and I went right into it. But meanwhile, everybody's running out on the racetrack to see if everybody's all right. And I get upside down and everything else, and I go to get out of the car, and every time I stuck my head out, bam, they punch me in the head. But that's the way racing was back then. We actually would bring the beer into the pits and stuff. And the official called me drinking a beer. It was after the warm-ups, and I was sweating. It was my first race I was ever in, and the sweat was just rolling off me. And the official came out and said, "Do you have a beer?" And I said, "You want one?" He said, "No." He said, "You can't race." I said, "What are you talking about?" He said, "Well," he said, "you can't drink and then drive." So the mechanic got into the car, which he had more beers than I had, but he was a pretty big guy. And he ended up getting third that night. But that was my original deal at Flemington. And then we went to Nazareth, and then the car broke down, and then the following week I come back to Flemington. I didn't do as good as the guy. And we're in a feature, and the feature hasn't gone yet. And Hoop Child was starting on the pole. And I was in the back, all of a sudden he jammed his brakes on and stops the whole race and everything else. And I said, "What the hell is going on?" And Hoop jumps out of his car and runs across the racetrack and picks this skunk up by his tail. It comes on over, and this guy comes out with a bag and he dropped it in the bag. I said, "I don't believe this. This is incredible."
I saw some pictures of that, you know, that actually happened.
You stay with it. I want you to go back and think about maybe some incident with Gerald that might have fueled some discontent or something from your mind that just told you that this guy was fantastic.
Yeah, I just remember when he come down to Flemington, it took him for a while. I don't know, sir. And then once he did, he was hard to step. And then he had something under the car. And I said to him, I said, "Girl, can I see what you got there?" He says, "Yeah, go ahead." And he's one of the first guys that can have a picture. And we got the picture on him. Then we started running with him. Until then, he was a man part of me.
Well, those two championships, they were hard to come by because the roster at Flemington was that difficult. And to watch this, all you guys in action, for all of us, it was just a thrill.
Well, we happen to grow up in an area where I agree a place was special. You had you, you had Taz and 80, you had Stan Blosky, you had me, and you had four or five other guys that would, you could hardly pick a night where one guy was going to dominate. But you kind of did that for a while, entertaining. He was the only guy with a Ford motor too, and that made us proud. When you first started racing Farmington, Sammy, it was boards all the way around, and then eventually they changed it to the high guardrail. Any difference as you attacked the track?
Yeah.
Well, it was two boards high. It had a rear tire. That's what happened to me on that. I caught a guy's wheel in the second turn, and the car fell up on the guardrail side. And Paul didn't have enough money to finish the board. He cut it off at the second turn. And I hit the car sideways on that board and cut the car right in half. And I landed in the back. We had a beer can back in the back for a fuel cell. And I landed behind right by the fuel cell in the back, the beer can. And to get out of the car, I had to climb out where the transmission was.
Oh, boy.
And I said to myself, boy, I'm not going to listen to you. But we didn't have no uniform.
That's right.
It was a t-shirt day.
How about yourself? Fond remembrances of Flemington?
Well, Flemington always go down. I think they're one of the better racetracks I've ever been on. I mean, it was challenging in all kinds of different directions. I mean, you could run a high gear and where you get it wound up, and then you could run a lower gear to get going in the game. And if you took notice of the driver left front and went to other racetracks, he was kind of dominant.
No question about it.
I think it was the speed that he had. I mean, I'm sure it's a lot faster now, but back down our way, you're talking about 99, 95 miles an hour or something like that. And we went to a smaller track, and it was like we was out of competition. We were doing like dominating. We would run the charge. And when Gerald came down, I got to admit, he taught me how to kind of like run on the high side.
Now you competed against Gerald at the Langhorne Speedway as well, and if remembrances of Langhorne, that was a crazy facility in itself.
Langhorne was a crazy track, shaped like a D, and if you really got wound up good, you had to watch it. You was in a slide all the way. And it was just a heck of a track. It was different.
You had was it at Trenton where you had the brake fluid problem?
Yeah.
You don't want to talk about that, do you?
I had a car at Trenton. It was out of sight. West Virginia, and the guy was checking the master cylinder, and he couldn't get the container built, so he put it in a Coke can. And he checked the master cylinder. Of course, my buddy, he was the cheap guy. He seen this Coke can open, and he said there was stuff in it, and he put it in the cooler. So I come in to make a pit stop, and he says, here's the Coke. And I took two swigs of it, went right down the thing. I could feel it right down my chest, the whole deal. And I jumped out of the car and there was a hot dog stand like about 25 feet away. And I jumped over the hot dog stand and stuck bread down my throat and threw up. And that was the end of it. It made me stop.
Oh, no question about it. That's one of those crazy stories in life, eh?
Yeah, that's a crazy one. You ain't kidding.
Well, Sammy, we thank you for coming out today and, of course, honoring the great Gerald Chamberlain.
Gerald, I'm proud to be one of your friends.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, Sammy Beavers!